Amen. Wherever the rivers of living water flow, it brings healing. God has called us to bring healing to the nations. God has called us to bring healing to the broken. It's not just for somebody in the worship team, or it's not just somebody for who is preaching. It's for each and every child of God. How many children of God are here? Amen. We all are the children of God. Yeah, I think the Sunday school can leave. Slowly. Children, come this side. You know that is there, no? Go this side. Yeah. Be very careful with the equipments. So krantarabashilere kentare. Glory. Sikrantarabasekantarabalaka. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Holy Spirit. So the Lord said, out of you shall flow rivers of living water. Amen. So when the rivers of living water flows through us, it not only heals us, but brings healing to somebody else. And the Bible says, wherever it goes, it brings healing. Wherever it goes. So we, each one of us, are called to live a life wherever we go, we bring healing. Wherever we go, we bring restoration. Wherever we go, we bring salvation. Hallelujah. That's how our lives are supposed to be. That's how our life is supposed to be. Amen. God doesn't do magics in this world. He doesn't do magic. He does miracles. Amen. He does miracles. Okay, let's get into the word. Can we come a little closer? So, thank you, Jesus. We worship you. I know God is going to talk to each one of us today, because this word, what I'm going to share, is something that God put in my heart so strongly. And God has been again and again confirming to me. And I know this word is for each one of us. Hallelujah. So be attentive. The Lord is about to speak something to us and going to do some transformation in our lives today. That is for good. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So, just 2 weeks back, as I was just praying for the church, the Lord gave me this word. As I was just praying, the Lord said, people are trying to please me with their intellectual wisdom. They're trying to know me through their intellectual wisdom. Hallelujah. Amen. And they are struggling. They are struggling. So when God told me to pray, and I was just praying for the church, and God was telling that you have to break those strongholds. Amen. If you see in the Bible, who are these Pharisees and Sadducees and those people? Who are they? The high priest. Who are they? They are people filled with wisdom. They are people who knew God's word very nicely. Yes? The high priest. They knew the word of God so, they knew the laws of the Lord so well. They were fasting and praying. Right? They were offering sacrifices. But every time when Jesus was talking to Pharisees, what was he telling them? When he was talking to the high priest, what was he telling them? Was he acknowledging or he always find him rebuking them? Why? He said, you're worshipping me with your mouth, whereas your heart is far away from me. Hallelujah. Shantale kendere. That very high priest who knew the law of God from Genesis to Micah never could discern that Jesus was the Son of God. And Peter, a fisherman who had no clue what was written in the Word of God, looked unto Jesus and he said, where will I go, Lord? For you have the words of life. Hallelujah. Shakan tele me sekandare. The Pharisee, he knew everything in the Bible. He knows. He said, Lord, I am fasting and praying. I am paying your tithes. What touched the Lord? A poor widow. She gave all that she had into the offering. That touched the heart of God. They were coming and telling, Jesus was dining along with his disciples, eating, having feasting, and they came and said, told to Jesus, we are fasting and praying. We are fasting and praying. Why are not your disciples fasting? Hallelujah! They were fasting, they were praying, and they never knew that Jesus was the Son of God. They could not discern. You could not discern the things of God with your knowledge. Everybody say, I cannot discern the things of God from my knowledge, from my mind, from my intelligence. Glory, Sankha Telere Shantare. The Ishwala Baramana. Let's all turn towards James chapter 3. Oh, thank you, Holy Spirit. Be open. God is going to do something. Some things are going to be broken today as the word is going to be shared in your life. Something God is going to do. I knew it. Who is wise and understanding among you? Let him show by good conduct that his works are done in the meekness of wisdom. But if you have bitter envy and self-seeking in your hearts, do not boast and lie against the truth. Okay. This wisdom does not descend from above, but is earthly, sensual, demonic. Next. For where envy and self-seeking exist, confusion and every evil thing are there. Next. But the wisdom that is from above is pure, peaceable, gentle, willing to yield, full of mercy and good fruits, without partiality and without hypocrisy. You see, there are two kinds of wisdom mentioned. How many wisdom do we know? What is wisdom? Okay, let's go. Basic English. What is wisdom? Huh? Jnanam. What is jnanam?
I didn't ask translation, I asked the meaning.
What is wisdom? Intellectual? Ability? Okay. What's the difference between wisdom and knowledge?
Knowledge is like something we know.
You know. Okay, we know. We know through reading. We know from listening, from hearing, through all these things we come to know, right? What is wisdom then? Practical, inbuilt. So knowledge is not inbuilt. So you look at a scientist and you call him, he's wise or knowledgeable? You look at a scientist, you call him wise or do you call him knowledgeable? Why not wise? He's a scientist. Most of the scientists are theoretical, right?
They derive from theory. And it's always a theory. Formulas. Theory. No, when we look at wisdom, it's nothing but your practical application of knowledge. Okay? So they say, okay, wisdom is a practical application of your knowledge. Okay. So if you read in Greek, the word is called Sophia, which means practical wisdom, prudence, skill, enlightenment, a right application of knowledge, and the true nature of thing. Okay. So this is what, now we, most of the time we are not able to differentiate between what is wisdom and what is knowledge. Okay, they are two different, they have completely two different meanings. A wise person may not be knowledgeable. A knowledgeable person may not be wise. Okay, a knowledgeable person may not be wise. How many times? Okay. The Bible says, those who say there is no God, they are fools. Many scientists say, Darwin theory and all the other theories you have, Stephen Hawking, they all say what? No God. So who are they? Fools. Are they knowledgeable? So much. So much. So there's always a lot of difference between knowledge and wisdom. And you don't comprehend God with just knowledge. You comprehend Him with wisdom. And as we see from these verses, there are two kinds of wisdom. There are two kinds of wisdom. And the first thing it says that, okay, let's go to verse 13. Who is wise and understanding? Now James is talking to a set of believers here. He's not writing this one for an unbeliever. If you go through the word, complete chapter of James, he speaks to believers. He says, who is wise and understanding among you? The next one, I think where it is called demonic, right? Sensual, earthly. Okay. Now this wisdom does not descend from above, but is earthly, sensual, and demonic. There is a wisdom which is very earthly, which is very sensual, and which is very demonic. Earthly. When you hear the word earthly, what do you mean? Temporary. That is what you're seeing in your natural realm, right? Earthly is nothing but what you see in your natural realm. Sensual. How many senses we have? What are the five senses? Touch, feel, taste, hearing, see. Okay. You comprehend something with these five senses. It's called an as earthly wisdom. You comprehend something with these five senses. They are called what? Earthly wisdom. Because only if you see, you will believe. Right? Only if you hear, you'll think, oh, it may be true. Right? Only if you touch, you'll know, okay, this is what it is. Right? So, there is a wisdom that is very earthly, that is very sensual and demonic. And what are those kind, what is constituting this one? If you read in, just a verse before. But if you have bitter envy, self-seeking in your hearts, do not boast and lie. See, these wisdom, the wisdom which is very earthly, which is bound to five senses, are, if you actually look deep inside, they will be carrying either envy, they will be having self-seeking, and they will not be able to accept the truth. It is very true. People inside the church or outside the church, okay, your friends, you have your unbeliever friends, you look into their lives. Their life is fully motivated by only selfish desires, self-seeking.
I want to do this in life. I wanted to achieve this in life. I wanted to do this. I wanted to do that. I had to have my own family. This, etc., etc., etc. Yeah? Envy, jealous. And do not boast and lie. And they lie against the truth. They are not able to accept the truth. You go to somebody and say, God is good. God, Jesus is the only true God. How many times they ask, they fight against you? Yes? How many times they question you back? Atheist. They try to reason out. They reason out from their mind. That's an earthly wisdom. That's an earthly wisdom, which is demonic. Next one, 15. Shakalantare. Okay. The next one. For where envy and self-seeking exist, confusion and every evil thing is there. Wherever this earthly, sensual, demonic wisdom is there, it always brings confusion. It always brings self-seeking, and every evil thing will be there. Even in the life of believers who say we have accepted Christ, yet when our minds are not transformed, we behave in this wisdom. We behave so earthly, we behave so sensual, sometimes we behave so demonic. Most of our prayers will be always self-seeking. Most of our life will be led in confusion. And most every evil thing you will see. That is why some people you feel they look, come to church for many years, but if you look at their behavior, their character, nothing would have changed. They might be the first in the church. They might know from Genesis to Revelation. Everything will be, they know everything. But there is no transformation inside. That's why the Bible says, knowledge puffs up. Knowledge puffs up. The earthly wisdom is very prideful. The earthly wisdom is very prideful. That's why it's self-seeking. And somebody do not appreciate you, you get offended. When somebody do not acknowledge you, you get offended. When somebody does not appreciate you, you get really offended. What am I? Who am I? They don't understand my worth. They don't understand. I have a self-respect. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So, wherever that earthly wisdom is there, self-seeking, confusion, no peace in the heart. It's always I. It's always I. My life. This does not come. That's why when Aryan was leading worship, he was telling one thing. Sometimes we are not able to thank God for what we have. We always look for what is not there. That's earthly wisdom, which is very sensual. You can see some knowledgeable people, they sound very good. But if you give them any correction, they can never take that in their heart. So egoistic in heart. Cannot yield. Get so quickly offended. Become prideful. Our egoistic heart means a demonic wisdom. A willingness to yield is a heavenly wisdom. So when God is giving you a correction, do not harden the heart. Amen. We worship Him from our heart, not from our mind. That is why Pharisees could not discern, whereas Peter was able to discern that he is a son of God. Hallelujah. It's full of mercy and good fruits, without partiality and without hypocrisy. I wanted to tell about hypocrisy because it's in the church platform. We are all believers here. How many believers are hypocrites? Let's go to 1 Timothy chapter 4. As I was worshiping, the Lord put this into my heart that I have to speak upon this. 1 Timothy chapter 4 verse 1 onwards. What is the meaning of, who are hypocrites? What's the meaning of hypocrisy? In inwards they are something else. Yes? They are so knowledgeable when they speak, whereas in their heart they are totally a different person. Now the Spirit expressingly says that in the later times some will depart from the faith. That means what? It's talking to unbelievers or believers? Believers. And Timothy was a pastor and Paul was Paul was actually guiding and encouraging Timothy in the way that he should be leading the church. So now the Spirit expressingly says that in the later times some will depart from the faith, giving heed to deceiving spirits and doctrines of demons. Next. Speaking lies in hypocrisy, having their own conscience seared with hot iron. These people speak doctrines from the Bible, whereas their heart is seared conscience. Is seared. What is seared conscience? Seared is a place, in Tamil we call marathu ponadu. That is no sense. You do anything, you will have no sense in that. Huh? Numbness, yeah. Numbness. It's seared with a hot iron. Nice hot iron, you iron it. You cannot crush it. It's so stiff, it's so stubborn. It's so stubborn. Their heart is what? Hypocrisy. Running with knowledge. Cannot discern what is right from wrong. If you are a child of God and you are not able to discern what is right and what is wrong, that means you are not walking in the heavenly wisdom. And how do you discern something is right or wrong? And you have one thing, that's the word of God. That's why the Bible says, anything that you exalt against the knowledge of God, against what God is telling you, you exalt anything else in your life against what God is telling you, that becomes a stronghold in your life, that becomes an idol in your life, and that will what will be ruling us. Hallelujah. So it is possible, and you come down, for the believers to get into the state. Fully of God, created to be received by thanks, to believe and know the truth. Next. For every good creature refuses with thanksgiving. Okay. Now the Spirit. Okay. For it is sanctified for the word of God and prayer. If you instruct the brethren, you will be a good believer. It comes the next, I think. It's, I think, 6th or 7th. If you instruct the brethren in these things, you will be a good minister of Jesus Christ. To whom are supposed to be instructing this one? To the one who's sitting inside the church. To the one who's sitting inside the church needed this teaching. Do not have a seared conscience, hypocrisy. Right? In your heart, you don't want to do it. But you're one person inside and outside another person. So good to talk and so knowledgeable. That's not a divine wisdom. Because God is watching. Why? Because when a person is walking in the heavenly wisdom, in the wisdom of God, automatically their actions and their life will have a lot of difference. And others will be noticing that. If your life is not noticed by somebody else, that means you have to go and notice what is going on in your life. Joseph, who acknowledged it? Who acknowledged Joseph? A Gentile. Who acknowledged Daniel? A Gentile. And if your unbelieving friends are not able to find any difference in you, they're not able to acknowledge God through your life, that means, go check back, what kind of a wisdom are you walking? What kind of a wisdom are we walking in? Let's not be a hypocrite. Let's not be a hypocrite. I know somebody, family keep full volume inside their house. Full songs means big, big volume. But you dig deep inside their life. Outside, I'm a Christian. I go to church. Word of God, you know, I'm a Christian. Who are you to talk about my... Who are you to, you know, not asking me to reduce the volume in the house. I will do all these things. You dig deep inside their life. There are struggles. They are still egoistic, still prideful. And others can easily notice that. Others could easily notice that. A life. Do you know how many are watching you? The host of heaven is watching you. The host of hell is watching you. And the earthly people are watching you. You don't know. You feel that, who am I? There's no other work for each one have their own trouble. No. I never thought people are watching me. I never thought I'm living my life. Later, in many instances and circumstances of my life, I began to notice people are just watching me. They're watching how I speak. They're watching how I talk. They're watching what's going on in a house. Now I'm all the more careful. It's serious. When we first came to this colony to live, I was just thinking people, but I never knew so many were watching us. They know so many about us. We hardly speak to people. He hardly speaks to anybody. He comes out, he has his own garden to look. Few people he knows and hey, hi, hello. He does that. He knows people, but hi, hello. How are you? Everything is fine. At least I speak with, you know, we have ladies, you know, ladies are there. So I speak all these other stuff. I don't speak much anything about our family, from where we have come, what we are, nothing. People have watched our lives so closely. And it was so surprising. We used to talk. People have no other work. They are watching us. They are watching us. Don't think nobody is watching you. You have the host of heaven watching you. You have the host of hell watching you. And you have a handful, a bunch of amount of people are watching us. So many are watching us. So many are watching us. It's so easy. I still remember when I was in my office in Bangalore, I was working in a company and my manager was from IIM Calcutta. IIM, I think. It's in Calcutta. So that fellow was a Tamil guy only, but mostly spent his time north. And he was supposed to be a Christian, meaning he was born in a Christian family. But he does not have any affiliation or anything to God. So much bad opinion about Christians and very wrong opinion about churches. And they always have a mentality that they collect money and so many things. But he never goes to church. Once in a while he visits. So that kind of a guy. Somehow he recruited me. We're all in the same team, all in the same cabin nearby. He asked me to come on Sundays. I told I will not come on Sundays. And he know that. And he purposefully will try to pull me to come on Sunday. I said no, for whatever reason it is. Even if I am not performing well, I am not bothered. But I am not going to come on Sundays. And then slowly he started, you must come on Saturdays. So few Saturdays I went. And I saw many other prayer, this thing I was not able to. Still I refused. Few Saturdays I went and still I refused. Every time we go for coffee, every time we go for lunch together, I will be keeping on boasting and bragging about Jesus and all those things. I was talking to him. Every time it ends with argument. At one point he got very angry. I was talking about Holy Spirit and he got his spirit. I said, you better be careful. Whatever you speak against the Holy Spirit, it will not be forgiven to you. No, I spoke. I didn't have that much wisdom that time. All I knew is this thing and I thought I was a very passionate. But if you look at my performance basically in the company, it was not very good. I wasn't really performing that well. At least to my knowledge, I was not really performing that well. To his knowledge, that fellow is from IIM. Now how he will think, how I will think. So how he will approach and how I will, there's a lot of difference that I couldn't even compare me with him. One day, but I still never stopped arguing with that guy. One day I was sitting in the chair and he was sitting. Instead of doing, we were working and suddenly we were talking something, it became an argument. I heard the voice of the Lord in my spirit so clearly. I was just talking to him with my mouth. Here I heard the voice, stop. Your life must show that I am with you. I shut my mouth in shame. I shut my mouth immediately. Argument was going on. Immediately I shut my mouth and I said, oh no, let's not argue anymore. And I just turned. From that day I stopped talking to him about Christ. So what am I saying? Don't try to serve God with your earthly wisdom. It's not going to work out. And the Lord told me, your life must show that I am with you. If your life is not showing, what are you preaching? If you cannot live what you preach, you might as well don't preach. I stopped. Then I began to meditate upon what God was saying. And I began to understand that I was really not living a life what God was intending to live. Because I still wasn't matured. Then I understood, okay, fine. But there was so much of favor that God was showing to me through him. So much, I just worked for a year and then I got married and I came here. And I was working with another company here. I never opened my mouth. I was a Christian and believe Christ, nothing. I never opened. I made sure I will not open. But you see, my manager was noticing me. There was one instance something happened. I said, he was a Brahmin and he said, I will not eat an eggless cake. I will eat only an eggless cake. With an egg cake, I will not eat. I told him, it is after a few months of this, and I told Murali, what if I give you this is an eggless cake? How do you know that? How can you identify whether it's egg or not? I already bought it and I came. He told me, I know you will not do it because you fear the Lord. I was a little surprised. I was a little surprised. I said, okay, this guy is watching, has watched me. He said, I know about Christians. They fear the Lord. You will not tell me a lie. I know. It was pretty surprised. He was not trying to please me by giving that word. When you know somebody is trying to please you by their talks, you will know that, right? I was surprised. I said, Lord, thank you. I pray that you make me live a life that will show Christ to the people. Then there was another guy who was a Muslim and he was trying to speak about Ramzan and all those things. I decided I will not argue with these guys anymore. No point. Our life, the presence of God within you, even without you noticing, it will go and touch the lives of somebody. That is what is called anointing. That's the heavenly wisdom. That's an heavenly wisdom. Hallelujah. That's a heavenly wisdom. So, what I wanted, okay, how to walk in divine wisdom. 1 Corinthians chapter 1 verse 30. Another couple of verses, we're going to stop. But of him who are in Christ, how many of you are in Christ Jesus here? You have a doubt. How many of you are in Christ Jesus here? Still some hands are down. You are not sure whether you are in Christ or out of Christ. Oh well, you are in Christ. That means what? Do you believe in Jesus? That means you are in Christ. That's why you must come to Bible study. Those who don't come to Bible study, this is a problem. We are teaching about Holy Spirit. Is it a blessing or not?
Yes.
Yes? We are really very good. We are going so slow, but still
I really encourage to take time and come for Bible study. So, but of him you are in Christ Jesus, who became for us wisdom from God and righteousness and sanctification. Where does Christ live? Many of you have no answers. Where is God? What is he doing? Where is the Holy Spirit? What, Vinay? You know and you are sitting, or you don't know or you have a doubt? Where is Holy Spirit? In your spirit. Okay. The Bible says, but of him you are in Christ Jesus, who became for us wisdom. If you have Jesus in you, it means you have wisdom in you. Okay? You're not going to ask God heavenly wisdom and he's going to pour out wisdom on you. No. He's not going to take a cup of oil and pour on you. He says, who became for us wisdom. Christ is the wisdom. And that Christ is in you, the wisdom is in you. If Christ is righteous, that righteousness is inside of you. So you are righteous. That's the wisdom of God. Your mind will say, you did a sin today, you are no more a righteous. But the word of God says, because you have Christ in you, you are righteous. So which will you believe now? You will believe that I did a sin, so I am a sinner. Or will you believe, I believe in Jesus, so I am righteous. Which one will you believe? That's the wisdom of God. This is an earthly wisdom. This is an earthly wisdom. Any thought that is not aligning with the truth of the word of God is a lie in your mind. Okay? That's not a heavenly wisdom. And righteousness and sanctification and redemption. There is a righteousness that God has imparted. You cannot become more holy than what God has already made you holy. You cannot, I want to repeat this, you cannot become more holy, more than what God has already made you to be holy, just because you believe in Christ. What you needed is sanctification. And that sanctification, Christ will be doing, living within you. So when God looks at us, he looks at us as his child. He looks at us as a holy one. He does not look at us as a sinner. Amen. And if you're struggling with guilt and condemnation and confusion, guilt is a selfish attitude. Condemnation is a selfish attitude. Whereas godly sorrow is a conviction. So if you're walking in guilt and condemnation, if you're keeping on falling into guilt and condemnation, that means what? You're walking in a earthly wisdom, not in a heavenly wisdom. If you're walking in a heavenly wisdom, you will get up and you say, Lord, I have done this mistake. I ask your forgiveness. I want you to sanctify me, because the word says he's our sanctification. I want you to cleanse me. I want you to change me. And then you raise up. You will receive. The Bible says heavenly wisdom is full of mercy. It's pure. It's holy. You will receive and you will walk. There is another earthly wisdom which says, I'm completely saved by grace. There is nothing I have to do. That's true. We are all saved by grace. That's an earthly wisdom. Yes, we are saved by grace. Nothing of our good works. Absolutely nothing. Yes. But if that grace is not empowering you to walk in the ways of God, that means what kind of a wisdom are you walking in? If the grace is able to save you, then the grace is also available to change you. You cannot just hold one part of grace and leave the other. Hallelujah. In what kind of a wisdom are we walking? So he is our righteousness. He is our sanctification. So the first thing, how to walk in divine wisdom, is to be conscious about who you are in Christ. Be conscious about who you are in Christ.
The wisdom is in you. The righteousness is in you. He will sanctify you. He will redeem you. It is no longer your strength. If you try to change yourself with your own strength, you're not going to be changed. But God still needs your cooperation. But what is He saying? I have put the wisdom in you. That wisdom which is in you will lead you and guide you in the ways that you have to walk. And when it is leading you, you may be falling down because you don't have the strength to obey. Because we keep falling in the lust of the flesh, we keep falling in the lust of the eyes, we keep falling in the pride of life. We are always looking at the world around. Whatever we see, we get tempted. Whatever we hear, we become fearful. Right? And what God says, James chapter 1, verse 5 and 6. If any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask of God. Hallelujah. The wisdom, God does not pour it from top. He gives you from within. The wisdom of God works from within you and starts controlling your thoughts, your feelings, and your emotions. So the godly wisdom which is in your spirit must begin to control your thoughts, must begin to control your emotions, must begin to control your feelings and control your ways and your talks. Amen. So how do you do that? Just simple. Let him ask of wisdom. When you're struggling in something, go to God and ask him, Lord, I'm struggling, help me. The heavenly wisdom always seeks help from God. The earthly wisdom will try to please God with his own strength. You can never fulfill the will of God in your life in your own strength. You can never fulfill the purposes of God in your life with your own strength. You have to have the strength of God, and that's called grace. So every time the wisdom of God rebukes you, receive the correction. Every time the wisdom of God comforts you, receive the comfort. Every time you fall, run to God. He will help you. He will strengthen. That is why it's called willingness to yield. He didn't ask you to change you. He says, just yield yourself into me. I will do the changing in you. Lord, I'm struggling to obey you. But your word says I must do it. Give me grace. Give me strength. Well, I'm trying to obey, sister, whatever you're saying, but I'm still not able to do. Why? You struggle with your own strength. Just go back to him and ask him. All it takes, ask him, Lord, give me strength. When you continuously ask this, I tell you, at one point of time, you will come slowly, even without your knowledge, you would have seen the old things passing away from you. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 17, 18, 19. When you have a problem, don't try to solve it with your own strength. Go back to the Word of God. Find out the ways in which you have to solve that issue. If you have a financial problem, go to the Word of God. Read and find out what you should be doing there. Are you paying your tithe properly? Are you giving your offerings? Are you a cheerful giver? Are you using the money wisely? Proverbs, you know, the word says to save. Don't be just so, this thing, you know, so unwise in handling your money. Simply spending for worthless things. The Bible instructs you in all these things. Read it. You know what I've done to raise the kids up? I took every word which is talking about children. I write it in a notebook. I keep reading it. Whatever I am supposed to do, I will see the instruction. Okay, from my side, what kind of things I have to do? The Bible says, train your child in the way that she should walk. Okay, in those, then I ask God, Lord, the word says train the child. So give me grace and wisdom so that I will know when to train, how to train. The Lord, the Bible says in Proverbs, when a child does a mistake, take a rod. So I ask the Lord, Lord, give me wisdom. When should I take the rod? I still keep praying that one. Why? Because I still have to change. Because sometimes it's so easy to lose all your patience with kids and finally go mad. So it's like I really needed the grace from the hand of God. So I said, Lord, okay, train, tell me, what should I do? Give me wisdom. There are times when I feel that I couldn't even control or make my kids understand what I'm trying to say. That is the thing when God reminds me, the Lord shall teach your children and great shall be their peace. That means what? You don't struggle with them. You cannot make them understand. I am the one who will be able to do that for them. Hallelujah. There are things we have to do. There are things we have to allow Him to do. How do you know in which situation how you will act? If you don't know the word, and if you do not have the Holy Spirit, if you're not yielding to the Holy Spirit, how do you know in what situation how you should act? In what situation you should open your mouth? In what situation you should shut up? In what situation you must act and what situation you should get back? How do you know? For every area of life, the wisdom of God is, the Lord says, if you lack wisdom, ask me. Ask me. Which step do I take? Which house should I buy? Which girl should I marry? Which boy should I marry? Should I take this job? Should I not take this job? He will guide you. Amen. Ephesians chapter 1 verse 17-89. By this we'll one more this and there's another verse. That the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father, may give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of Him. In the knowledge of Him, that the eyes of your understanding be enlightened. When I read this word first time, from that day, I began to pray over me the same thing. I repeat the entire Ephesians chapter 1 verse 17, 18, 19. If you go through our prayer points, that will be the first prayer point which we would have given. From the day that when I have begun to pray that prayer over me, I have seen myself a great difference. I have seen a lot of wisdom in me, in talking, in addressing, in understanding life, in understanding things, in doing what should I do, what should I not do. It just comes and flows from within me. It just flows. That's what the Bible says. The anointing shall teach you all things. You have to be so careful to pray this prayer over you. Lord, the spirit of wisdom, the spirit of understanding, open the eyes of my understanding so that I will know what is your calling in my life. You want to know what's God's purpose and what's God's will in your life? Ask Him to give you that spirit of wisdom and understanding. You have the spirit within you, okay? Say, Lord, open my understanding and show me what you have kept for me. I want to know that. What is your riches of the glory, the great inheritance you have for me? Show me, I want to know that. I tell you, over the years as I have prayed this, now I don't struggle to receive something from God. It's no more a struggle. It's no more a confusion. Hallelujah. The next verse, you can go home and read. Acts chapter 6 verse 10. And they are not able to resist. It was talking about Philip. Philip is a disciple of Jesus. Great. He was a man full of faith and full of power. Great signs and wonders was happening. And they were not able to resist the wisdom and the spirit by which he spoke. When you speak, others will shut up. That's the wisdom of God. They cannot resist you. They may crucify you, but they cannot resist you.
Which one is better?
They stoned Stephen, but they could not resist what he could speak. Since they could not resist what he could speak, that's the reason they stoned. You stone him and shut his mouth. Hallelujah. This is the kind of wisdom that must be operating through us. And if that's not operating, we might as well go home and check out, Lord, help me to walk in that wisdom, in that heavenly wisdom. I don't want earthly wisdom. I don't want sensual. I no longer want to walk in sensual wisdom. Hallelujah. Amen. Proverbs chapter 2 verse 10 and 11. You can go home and read. It says that wisdom will keep you, understanding will keep you, discernment. God's wisdom will give you discernment to know what is right and what's wrong. You received a prophecy and you do not know whether it's right or wrong. God's wisdom will lead you which is right or wrong. It gives you discernment. And children of God, I tell you, many people in the church, they just do not know how to discern things. I tell you, during the time of worship, when the anointing is flowing, there are some people you just cannot even discern what's flowing on. We just stand like that. You don't know what's going on because you're not able to flow with the anointing of God. You're not able to discern the presence of God. It's because your spiritual senses are not exercised. You're walking in your earthly wisdom. Working in the earthly wisdom, not able to discern what's going on in the spiritual realm. When the presence of God is so mighty in this place, we just stand like stones because we do not know. Hallelujah. You cannot discern the things of God with the earthly wisdom. It's through the heavenly wisdom, which is so holy, which is pure, which is willing to yield, which is without hypocrisy. Let us all rise up to our feet and say, Father, help me to walk in that wisdom. I no longer want it to be like a baby who is always double-minded, who's tossed with every wind of doctrine, who's tossed here and there. I want to discern the things of God. I want to walk in godly wisdom. Sharakante lereke sikara. In Ephesians, if you read, it says the manifold wisdom of God. You know why God saved us and put us in a church? Go read in Ephesians chapter 2, I think. It says 3:10. Okay, Ephesians chapter 3 verse 10. So that the manifold wisdom of God shall be manifested through the children of God to the principalities and the powers. God wanted his mighty wisdom should be manifested through us to the principalities and powers. We are not talking about a simple lame wisdom that just helps to run my job and my program and fix the bug. We are not talking that wisdom. We are talking wisdom. See, that is why if you look into the life of Peter, that fellow was an uneducated fellow. The Pharisees, they say, are these not the fishermen who are uneducated? How they are speaking, what they are speaking? They found so much wisdom in the words of Peter. You know, what is the wisdom of God here? Peter, he was ministering to the Jews. Usually Jews are pretty intelligent people. Most of the high profiles you see are Jewish people, right? Most of the high profiles in the world, if you see, they will be actually Jewish. They are so intelligent guys. And this wisdom, and this Peter, who was uneducated, God told him, you have to minister to the Jewish people. Whereas Paul, you know who's Paul? In those days, he's the PhD guy. He's a scholar. According to man's wisdom, we should have sent this Peter to the Gentiles. And we should have made the Peter, Paul to speak to Jews. To preach the gospel. And God did exactly the ulta. He sent Paul to the Gentiles. And he sent Peter to the Jews. That's the manifold wisdom of God. You are weak. So that why he did that? Because they know that Peter was an uneducated. If he's seeking so much, it's not him. It's God working through him. And Paul says, I consider everything as loss. Whatever he has studied, he has to unwind, unprogram, remove it from his mind. And he says, I have not come to you with my intellectual wisdom, but in the demonstration of signs and wonders. I have not come. So what has Paul had to do? He has now a bigger job to unlearn everything he has done and get down to that level of Gentiles and proclaim the gospel. That's the wisdom of God. He will take a meek person and bring them and make them stand before a king. He will bring the intellectual person to a zero level and use him. How much are we willing to yield? That much amount of wisdom will flow through us. How much are we yielding? That much wisdom you will see through us. Hallelujah. Raka sante rebe shaka le mantaraba sekhe rebataraba. In this moment of time, I just wanted to